Welcome. It's an absolute privilege for me to launch the brand new Center for Policy Research podcast, renamed India Speak. Last year, at the height of the first wave, as India and the world went into lockdown, the Center for Policy Research launched a podcast series that focused specifically on the multidimensional impact of the lockdown and the first wave of the pandemic. We explored its impact on the economy, on society, on foreign policy, and also, of course, looking at the unfolding dynamics of the pandemic and India's health system. After the first wave, India went into pandemic limbo, I would go so far as to say, in the hope we were nearing the end game and the worst of COVID was behind us. But the end of March, early April, brought a new tsunami. The second wave turned out not just to be far more virulent, but also far more lethal as a disease, affecting thousands of citizens across India's cities, now moving into rural areas and presenting a whole new set of challenges to our health system, to the economy, to indeed every underlying framework on which the basic social contract has been forged in Indian democracy. We relaunch and rebrand our podcast with a new series that explores the impact of the second wave on different aspects of our policy, our polity, our economy, our society. It's an absolute privilege for me, for our inaugural episode, have with us as our guest today, Pranjal Bhandari. Pranjal Bhandari is the Chief India Economist, Managing Director, Global Research of the Hong Kong and Shanghai Bank Cooperation, or the HSBC Bank in India. Pranjal has been closely tracking trends in the Indian economy for many years now, and the briefs that she puts out have given us deep insight into the unfolding dynamics of the economy in pre-pandemic times, but now, even more importantly, into understanding the impact of the pandemic from its lockdowns to the first wave and now the second wave on different aspects of the Indian economy. Pranjal, an absolute privilege to have you on our show. Thank you very much for making the time to join us today.
My pleasure, Yamini. It's great to be here.
Pranjal, let me start where this all began. The Indian economy back in March 2020 wasn't in the peak of health as India entered the first wave of the pandemic and announced its first lockdown. The lockdown seems to have had a significant impact on the Indian economy. In fact, the Indian GDP contraction was amongst the greatest across the globe. But slowly by September, we began to see some signs of recovery. However, like many other parts of the world, it does seem like our recovery was K-shaped and there were big scars in the economy. A lot of those scars are things that you have been pointing out to us in your work. So can you start by giving us your assessment of where the economy was in March 2020, before we were hit by the pandemic? What happened in that first phase of the lockdown and through the first wave? And what was the general trajectory of the economic recovery that we began to experience back in September last year?
Yeah, Yamini, I'm glad you've brought this up because it's really important to set the stage. Growth in the Indian economy has been slowing gradually over the last decade. So, you know, what economists like to talk about is potential growth, which is how high can your economy grow sustainably. That potential growth number about a decade ago was north of 7%. My own estimate is that on the eve of the pandemic, it was closer to 6%. It had already fallen by 1 percentage point. And I think there's an interesting story on why it had fallen. About 10 years ago, we suddenly realized that there was a lot of debt in our corporates and they were showing up as non-performing loans in our banks. And this twin balance sheet problem of high corporate debt and, you know, bad loans at banks was actually making banks very risk averse and credit growth was slowing. And when credit growth was slowing, then our investment cycle was slowing as well. And for a decade, if you had investment slowing, and you know, you can think about investment at the rate at which the economy creates new jobs, then jobs were slowing, wages were slowing. Did we do anything about it? Well, we did identify the problem and we spoke a lot about it. And there were a lot of plans, you know, now we have the insolvency and bankruptcy code, but we didn't really pursue it, you know, as much as we should have, for the simple reason, I think we got distracted. You know, we got distracted by some temporary sources of growth. For example, you know, oil prices fell, it gave us a growth boost. Suddenly there was a lot of liquidity with our shadow banks and they were lending and that was a temporary growth boost. So, you know, we got very distracted by those sources of growth and we didn't really work on the main problem, which was resolving our twin balance sheet issue. Investment, weak job growth, weak wages. Suddenly, we saw growth was slowing rapidly in 2019. You know, growth fell down, you know, from this whole 7-8% to closer to 4% in 2019. And then suddenly everybody woke up and said, oh, this is a demand problem. You know, wages have fallen and people are not buying things. But what they didn't realize was you could trace back the origin of this demand problem to, you know, weak balance sheets, supply side issues, which can only be resolved by very sort of, you know, very targeted reforms. So, you know, that is where we were. Growth had slowed a lot in 2019. There was a lot of policy push. For instance, the RBI cut rates aggressively in 2019. In 2020, the year started off a little well. You know, we thought it'll be a good year because 2019 had been so bad. January and February, some of the data we track, for example, industrial production, car sales, started to rise. And then suddenly, you know, we had the pandemic, the first wave of last year. And of course, everything came crashing down and India decelerated, you know, about 24% year on year in the April to June quarter last year. That's where we were last year. Coming out of the first wave of last year was another big learning, I must say. You know, the fall was dramatic in the April to June quarter with the national lockdowns, but the rise back up was also very dramatic in the July to September quarter. And when we look back into what really, you know, led to this big rise, it was a huge amount of pent-up demand. You know, I think the affluent classes of India who were just, you know, sitting at home, not spending, not doing, you know, not buying a lot of consumer durables, not taking foreign trips, ended up saving a lot of money. Financial savings in banks rose from 10% of GDP to 24% of GDP because they had nowhere to spend it. And as soon as the national lockdown went away, they started spending a lot of money and there was a lot of excitement. In fact, you know, everybody thought that, you know, India had actually improved after the first wave of the pandemic because the growth numbers suddenly started looking so good. But I think beneath all of this, there are a lot of scars which were not showing up, you know, in the second half of last year, but I think have worsened with the second wave. And I think, you know, and I worry about what's going to happen to both.
Thanks a lot, Pranjal. That's a really wonderful overview and brings us to a very critical issue that I want to talk about before we get into an understanding of your assessment of the impact of the second wave, which is about the scars. So you spoke about the huge pent-up demand, particularly amongst the affluent classes, and our savings rate rose. But India, through the first wave, also did relatively little compared to many other countries in terms of the fiscal stimulus it gave, particularly to the poorest Indians. So there was a big question mark around what happened to the labor market, especially amongst the poor. And some studies from CMIE point out that, in fact, there was an increase in formality in the labor market as many who were employed, they began to declare themselves as self-employed and so on. But also a lot of your work pointed out that in this phase, September onwards last year, we also saw that listed companies were beginning to make profit, perhaps as also a sign of pent-up demand. And you've also highlighted to us that there was a move towards deeper formalization of firms, possibly because of this pent-up demand. So can you explain to us a little bit about these scars, about the dynamic of formality and informality, both in firms as well as in the labor market. So we get a better sense of exactly where we were when the second wave hit.
Right. So look, there have been two scars that I've been, noticing over the last year that are beginning to show up. I'm worried will deepen further. One is the health of India's banks, and the other is, formalization. But what I call a distress-led formalization, which is stoking inequality. So let me start with the first, actually the two are also interlinked. Let me explain. The first one is the health of banks. Nobody's talking about this in markets, for example, right now, because so far banks are not showing any sign of deep stress. And the reason is because, there has been a lot of regulatory easing, a lot of liquidity has been given to the banking sector, to the economy. So it's not really showing up very much. Also, we've known from previous slowdowns that the banking sector stress shows up about a year or two after any slowdown. It doesn't show up immediately because, immediately there are a lot of other things you can do to cover up, to buy yourself some more time. RBI is infusing a lot of liquidity, banks sort of allow you to go easy on your repayment of loans, so you don't really get a good picture in up front. You sort of really see the scars 2-3 years down the line. We saw it in the last business cycle that we had. My worry is that non-performing loans at banks, which in my view was the main source of the slowdown in the last decade, is something that is not rising right now, but it could rise over the next year or two once the whole restructuring scheme and all have sort of ended. And that will make banks even more risk averse. Industrial credit is right now running 0% year on year. It's been practically been running negative growth in the last couple of years. And my worry is that if banks are not lending, the lender in chief is not working, then who funds growth? And this also has links with inequality. You see, the big firms, they can go to capital markets, they can raise money in equity markets, debt markets. It's your medium firms and small firms who rely disproportionately on banks. So if your bank is under stress, very worried about bad loans, not being able to lend, then it is the medium and small firms, who sort of take a hit. So this is my number one scar. I'm worried about the health of the banking sector and its impact on growth and, inequality. My second scar that I worry about is inequality itself. The fact that over, the period of the first wave, we did see a lot of formalization, a lot of the demand moved from small firms to big firms. They showed up in the corporate profitability of big firms. But, my worry is that it may be short-lived, because at the end of the day, if it's distress-led formalization, because the informal sector is just basically distressed, and therefore the formal sector is taking up that place, then we must remember that 85% of our labor force works in the informal sector, 50% of our GDP is informal sector. This is going to weigh on demand over the next couple of years, and the business of the formal sector itself could be at some risk. So, these are the two scars that I'm worried about on the growth front. And I also worry that the second wave may have just deepened them.
So let's talk about the second wave. Give us a sense of what you think this the last 1 to 1.5 months mean for the Indian economy.
Right. So, I think there are characteristics of the second wave which are very different from the first wave. There are four differences in particular, which I think are stoking uncertainty this time. And I'm worried about the uncertainty angle of this wave, because, as John Maynard Keynes said a long time ago and has been borne by research since, that recovery is not just a function of your forecasts, your economic forecasts. It's also a function of the confidence you have around your forecasts. And if there's a lot of uncertainty in the horizon, then you're not really confident about any forecast you're making. And then, firms don't invest, people don't hire, people don't buy things, and then, growth doesn't pick up. And my worry is that the second wave has come in with a huge amount of uncertainty. Let me point out four. number one is, you know, the whole local lockdown versus national lockdown. A lot of people are heaving a sigh of relief that, look, it's not a national lockdown. You know, it's okay. It's better for economic growth. Perhaps it is. But, you know, state level and local lockdowns also come with a lot of uncertainty. You know, which state is going to go next? How long, you know, will it continue? What is going to happen to interstate trade? We're already seeing data in e-way bills in May, which have come crashing down. So the uncertainty around, you know, which state will do what when, that's the first one. The second difference is this time the second wave has hit the affluent class a lot. You know, we have data from the Mumbai Municipal Corporation, which shows that this time 90% of the cases in Mumbai have been in high rises. In the first wave, 30% of the cases were in high rises. The others were in the slums. So it's really hit the affluent class, you know, who move a lot of money and who came back strongly pent up demand last year. But this year, their sentiments may be very weak. And there's a lot of uncertainty around that. The third difference is the whole rural spread. The fact that this time the pandemic is showing bigger signs of spreading into rural India. What it does to rural demand, rural growth is, you know, a big question mark. And a fourth difference this time is what is happening to manufacturers. You see, what happened last time was, you know, growth fell, but even commodity prices fell. You know, oil prices fell, and you know, there was not a lot of pressure on the cost front, and the firms sort of were able to tide through it. This time, you know, demand has fallen, but commodity prices have risen. You know, oil prices are up, you know, dramatically. Metal prices are up. Global prices are up, and all of this is basically hurting profit margins of corporate India. You know, corporate India is finding it very hard to pass on all of these cost increases to consumers because they are very worried that will lower demand. So right now they're taking it on their profit margin, but we'll have to see how long that continues. So this is, you know, one other difference this time around. I think all of this together means that the, you know, that even once we are done with the second wave, there will be a lingering uncertainty in the system that could keep growth weak. So, you know, of course, April to June will be weak growth because of the lockdowns. But my worry is that June to September could also be relatively weak because of all the uncertainty in the system.
And do you see the two scars that we spoke about just a short while ago, the scars in the banking system and the distress formalization in the economy, would that exacerbate given the backdrop of these conditions that are of the second wave that have made the economic hit somewhat different to the first?
Yes, you know, I think so. As in, you know, it's very difficult for the informal sector to be punched on its face, you know,
twice in a row
for 2 years. Also remember, Yamini, that, you know, the informal sector was already struggling a little bit. You know, it has faced a couple of punches in the last couple of years, as in there was demonetization, there was GST implementation, and then pandemic first wave, and now quickly after that, the pandemic second wave. So yes, you know, I do worry about it a lot. And, you know, the longer this lasts, you know, if we come to a third wave, more lockdowns, I worry that it could, you know, continue for even longer, and, you know, the scars could deepen. You know, I also must say that there's one thing I've learned in this pandemic, which is that we can't wish away the informal sector. You know, for the longest time, our policymakers have, you know, sort of thought that the formal sector and informal sector move together. You know, they go up together, they come down together. So the policies we make, which will help the formal sector, will also help the informal sector. But, you know, we've had this experience now for the last couple of years where the informal sector has done much worse than the formal sector. And this is something we have to now acknowledge very clearly. And my point is we have to bring the informal sector at the heart of policy, you know, at the center of the whole stage, and make policies thinking about how they will react. I'll give you two examples in which, just because we did not think about the informal sector separately, we actually bungled up a little bit. One was the national lockdown last year, It worked for a lot of the advanced economies, the US, Eurozone, and so on. But for us, it led to a lot of people, those working in urban India without social security, walking back home hundreds of kilometers. We hadn't really thought about how they would react before we, announce a national. Even the inflation we saw last year, we were the only country who was seeing high inflation. Everywhere else, inflation was brick. And the inflation we saw last year was on the back of disruption in informal sector. A lot of informal sector produces essentials like clothing, food items, for which demand never really falls. Because there was so much of disruption in the informal sector, supply issues, inflation, and we saw high inflation and nobody else in the world saw high inflation. So we have to think differently. We have to, account for our informal sector when we make policies.
What you say is so, so important. I'm going to sort of ask you a question which takes us slightly a divergent path from the core issue we are talking about. But I think it also is at the center. As you say, we have to bring the informal economy into the center of our understanding of the Indian economy. But if you look at some of the big policy shifts that India made over these last few years, demonetization, GST, two important ones. One of the underlying elements of these policy shifts was to try and push for deeper formalization of the economy. In some senses, our approach to the informal economy has always been, we need to use policy to make the informal economy formal. So a different kind of formalization to distress formalization, but an attempt to formalize nonetheless. And it does seem like in some senses, these policy measures actually made the problem much greater than if we had found some alternative tools to strengthen the informal economy and to enable it to at least get the advantages of what players in the formal economy experience. Just wanted to get your thoughts on this, because I think it's going to be so crucial also to the kind of policy response we build, both to the immediacy of the second wave and the recovery.
Yeah, so look, a formalization is good. I'm all for formalization. It basically means that, firms are able to get access to, capital, want to grow, they are in the formal, they get access to technology. I think I'm all for formalization. My problem is that we need to differentiate between distress-led formalization and organic formalization. My worry is that, distress-led formalization is not long-lasting. It's not sustainable. Two things can happen. One, what my worry is for the future, that, some people are doing well, the formal firms are doing well, but the informal firms are and workers in those firms are doing so poorly that the fall in their wages, the fall in their demand will also slow down the growth of the formal sector. So that is, one type. Other problem I have with stress-led formalization is that actually sometimes it doesn't last. We saw in demonetization, when we study corporate data, we see that some formalization had happened after demonetization, but it just petered off. For the simple reason, the ecosystem had not really changed and the formal sector made a comeback. It was a little weaker than before, but it did make a comeback. So it didn't really last. It wasn't sustainable. My point is that we must think about organic formalization. The formalization that happens on the back of regulation becoming more supportive for firms to grow from informality to formality, for firms to get access to capital and grow gradually, regulatory burden coming off, this reforms-led formalization, which is organic. I think that is the formalization we want, and that is the formalization we should aspire for.
Absolutely. I think this gives us the seeds of what I hope will be a second conversation with you at sooner than later to deep dive into what you rightly described as organic formalization, which really has to be the backbone for the Indian economy. But Pranjal, how does all of this come together then in what we should expect from government? If we look back to last year, by I think the 14th or 15th of May, if I'm not wrong, we already had the unfolding of the sort of Atmanirbhar Bharat plan for relief and recovery. We still await a word from the Ministry of Finance in terms of what it intends to do. But there were sort of two questions I wanted to pose to you on this. Of course, your overall views on what direction the policy response should be. But, you know, last year, the RBI kind of led the way when it came to sort of providing a stimulus to the economy, and our fiscal response was somewhat limited. Do we still have the kind of momentum for the RBI in the current scenario, or does this now have to be a fiscal stimulus led by the Ministry of Finance? Your thoughts on that before we come to the policy response.
Yeah, sure. So look, you know, what we're seeing right now is that the advanced economies have started to grow very quickly, far higher growth than emerging markets. In fact, the differential of economy growth and emerging markets growth is at its highest in, you know, last many years, you know, multiple decades. And what is happening is actually pretty tragic for emerging markets. What is happening is that because of advanced economy growth, you have commodity price going up, and this is not suiting the emerging markets where growth has not really taken off as much. You know, one of the big reasons is vaccination. Vaccination rates are much lower in emerging markets, and on top of that, they have to face you know, higher commodity prices. So that is a problem right now, and because of that, you know, inflation is a big worry. We got a lot of inflation data over the last week. We right now have wholesale price index inflation running more than 10% year. Out of that, if you actually single out the input price components, those are running around 15% year on year. At some point, manufacturers will pass on these input prices to output prices, and then there could be sort of, you know, big inflation worries you know, across the board, all goods, all commodities, all finished goods, all finished goods as well as commodities. So that inflation is a big worry. So I think in a way RBI's hands are tied at this point. My sense is that you know, it can stick to what it already has. For example, it, you know, rates are already low. RBI's stance is already accommodative. RBI has already promised that it will keep infusing a lot of liquidity. It will help the government, both the center and the state, with its borrowing plans, try to keep bond yields low by buying bonds. Continue with all of this, you know, as long as is needed. Even on the regulatory front, the RBI has already announced a restructuring plan, you know, a second restructuring plan for the second wave. It's called for a new COVID loan book. It has taken a few steps, and I think in a way, my sense is it has done everything that it could. Anything more it does from here could also have side effects, and you don't want to become a victim of side effects that are working for you. So I think RBI has done whatever it could. I think now the entire responsibility is on the government. There is a lot, you know, that it can still do. Fiscal deficit problem first. A lot of people are very worried about high fiscal deficit, high public debt, and that's a problem around the world. But the only way for us to bring down public debt over time is to increase growth. So we now need good, targeted, high quality spending that will ensure that, you know, no sector in our economy is so distressed that it actually brings down growth. So good quality fiscal spending right now will actually bring down the public debt over time. Also, the other thing we have right now, you know, it's actually come from nowhere, which is that the central government ended the last fiscal year with pretty high cash balances, more than 3 trillion rupees. So that is something it can use for this year. So that's sort of a little bit of money it has got. So I think fiscal space is there. In my view, I think what it should, I think the permanent stimulus through all of this is vaccination. Anything it needs to spend to increase the vaccination rate, any spending for healthcare has to be a priority. But beyond that, there is so much of food grains in our granaries, continuing to increase the food distribution scheme, PM Kisan, Narega works, where we're seeing that demand is outpacing supply recently. I think all of that is very important. Sadly, we don't have an urban social welfare scheme, that has been a glaring deficiency, which I hope we can do something about over time. But until we don't have one, I also think that the CapEx promise that the government made in its February budget, the fact that it'll do a lot more capital expenditure than before, I still hope they stick on to that, because that is probably the only way you create at least some urban jobs. So my sense is that, government expenditure should not fall, rather it should rise. We should not worry about the fiscal deficit, and we should be thankful that we have good amount of surplus cash from last year, which we can use this year.
So the government of India certainly has its job cut out for itself. Pranjal, just one last question. What about state governments? No doubt the bigger brunt of expenditure, particularly health expenditure, rests with the states. The COVID itself is unfolding differentially across states. As you said, we are seeing lockdowns much more localized. Different states are going into lockdowns at different points in time. But after last year, where state budgets too saw a significant from the lockdown, and state borrowing was quite high. What do you think states should be doing right now in terms of their own budget management and cash flow management to be able to better respond to the crisis that they are confronting?
Yeah, so many states are already, have already announced some relief packages. Before the second wave hit, the consolidated fiscal deficit budget estimate for FY22 for states was 3.3% of GDP, which I think is relatively low. I think this can easily be scaled up. They started the year off a bit, being a bit conservative. Also, remember, oil prices being high, in a way is good for states, because it increases their tax revenues, because they have added taxes on oil. So that is like a positive. Beyond that, my sense is that RBI will be helpful to state finances as well. RBI has come out with this new policy, the GSAP, which is buying bonds. It's telling you upfront how much it will buy, and it's buying bonds. It's mostly central government bonds right now, but hopefully over time, over the next couple of months, it can also start buying more of state government bonds. It's something that it started last year. Maybe it can do more of that, and that will help the state financing. But generally speaking, with the help of RBI and their own, some increase in oil revenues, I do think that states should not worry about their fiscal deficits going up at this point. They had budgeted 3.3. They have a little more headroom. I think they can go up to 4.
So both Government of India and states have their task cut out for them. But most importantly, as Pranjal Bhandari reminds us, they also have some fiscal headway to be able to do what is needed to help the economy slowly come back on track, even as we battle this extremely virulent second wave. Pranjal Bhandari, thank you so much for joining us. It's been, as always, a deeply insightful and enlightening conversation, and very clear in terms of what the key policy next steps have to be as India recovers from COVID. Thank you very much, and look forward to talking to you again on formalization and the potential reform pathways at some point soon.
Thanks for having me, Amini. It was a great discussion.
Thank you again for listening to India Speak. Over the next few weeks, we will bring you a range of insights from CPR experts as well as other stakeholders in the policy landscape to better understand different aspects of the impact of the second wave. Do follow us on Twitter at @CPR_India and on LinkedIn, Facebook, and of course, our website www.cprindia.org. Thank you, and see you next time.